let's start by going to my first slide, my cover slide. I want to start by talking a little bit about the economy around us, because I did talk about that last year, and I wanted to touch on that before I get into it. I think it's really important because, you know, no business operates independent of macroeconomic conditions around them, and that's certainly true for Autodesk and all of our customers. And, you know, what I can say is what a difference a year makes, really. I mean, things are better. Things aren't great. Things haven't completely resolved. And, you know, the world continues to face challenges, you know, at every turn. Witness, you know, the oil crisis in the Middle East right now. Witness the Japanese tsunami and earthquake and tsunami. We have problems that we're facing. And we're also not out of this macroeconomic recession. Unemployment is continuing to be fairly high in tier one countries. There's still a boom going on in some of the emerging markets. But I'll tell you, from the conversations I've had over the last 6 to 12 months, the AEC industry is starting to see light. It's starting to see pipelines grow, activity, you know, come back. There's confidence in the professionals out there, whether it's architects who probably got the hardest hit by this recession, all the way through to contractors, civil engineers, owners, etc. I'm starting to see positive energy again, which is really good. And, you know, I think it's important because, you know, that Autodesk be there as a partner to these companies and really help guide and facilitate some of the change process. And that's one of the things that I think has really been important around this economic recession that we've experienced the last 2 or 3 years. Industry professionals, because of the strains and pressure on their business, are looking much more aggressively at the workflow. They're looking at how do we solve the age-old historic problem of building process, and how do we change the waste piece, 25-30% of any given construction project allocated to waste. How do we repatriate some of those dollars? How do we move them back to bottom line profit? How do we generate more efficient, more effective construction? And I think that really favors Autodesk. You know, because our technology portfolio is really meant to solve that problem. You know, I talked about, I certainly talked about it in one-on-ones, but I think the best companies, you know, take tough times and double down and really try to improve themselves during really difficult times. And that's exactly what we've done in the last 12 months. We have looked at this recession, square in the eyes, and we did not downsize our development. We did not downsize our computer science. We have the richest set of products that we've ever had coming out of this recession. We've never had this rich set of products, even out of the great times. And I think, you know, you start to see BIM take share. You start to see Autodesk, BIM, have a bigger footprint in the industry because we are absolutely expanding our technology portfolio and driving that. So we're really excited about what we have to show you, and I think you'll see that as we go through the next couple of days. And, you know, what's really interesting with this process change in the industry, with professionals looking at their workflows and trying to determine how do I change the dynamic, BIM has become an incredibly important idea. It always has been an important idea, but it's expanded even further as an idea and as a concept across segments and across workflows. BIM absolutely resonates now as a concept of change. Not a model-based design technology or better visualization, not necessarily defined as IPD or VDC. BIM is a big idea in the industry right now. People are talking about BIM to represent lots of different things, not just technology or workflow, but advanced ideas across the segments as well. And you're starting to see BIM helping entire global AEC supply chain, all the way up through to owners, you know, realize benefit and realize efficiency at every phase of the process. Now, Autodesk's BIM portfolio, it really takes advantage of that core thing that we created 7, 8, 9 years ago, which is that 3D model-based design technology that creates a data-centric approach to design. We're leveraging that and then doing more things with that data. Think about what Autodesk has tried to do in the last 7 or 8 or 9 years. We've tried to lay a foundation of information out to market with our technologies, so then we could help expand the concept of BIM with other technologies that leverage that information. We think 3D models improve accuracy around design and construction by creating coordinated and consistent information for design. We think they increase efficiency, and ultimately, Autodesk portfolio improves the sustainable result of designs and construction, and I think you'll see that through the presentation today. Let me talk about this expanded concept of BIM in the context of the building segment first. And I think it's important because in building, the idea of BIM has expanded both across workflows, which I'm going to talk about, but also across disciplines. Everybody, including the owner, is now benefiting from the concepts of BIM. And in this case, I want to show an example of how BIM has expanded from a workflow standpoint to the early stages of design. So what you're seeing here is a this is, I don't think, 3 or 4 or 5 years ago, some of you have been following this for a while, couldn't have imagined that Revit actually could create this kind of shape and design and in the early stage of concept design. But it's always been inside of Revit. So it's a very, very powerful model-based tool. And Revit can do conceptual designs like this port, Tianjin port in China, which was driven by CCDI Group. CCDI Group committed themselves to Revit, used it as a conceptual design tool to create some ideas to go through the idea generation, and then transition from that conceptual design right into production with the rich information following the process. And they finished their designs with the entire series, with AutoCAD Revit, but also with Max, 3ds Max Design, EcoTech, and Navisworks, do simulations and analysis. But it starts with the conceptual design. And early conceptual studies are a hallmark now of the BIM process. You'll see more and more of that in the workflow that our customers. Now, when you're in concept design, especially in the world that we live in today, where a lot of building, whether it's new building, but also renovation and retrofit, is driven through the ideas of sustainability and energy efficiency, you need to be able to do conceptual energy studies. You need to be able to do things in concept design before you get to production that can inform your process. And so one of the things that we've really worked on over the last 12 months is integrating conceptual energy analysis into the concept design itself. This project is a post-occupancy energy analysis for the Independence Center in St. Louis, done by our customer ARPA Studios. And what they're trying to do is bring the concepts of EcoTech and Green Building Studio and in-product Revit analysis into the concept phase to really understand how simulation and analysis will affect design concepts. And so this is something you can see, this is imagery coming out of the energy analysis capabilities in concept design. Now, beyond concept design, it's really important that we acknowledge the movement of the building industry from new construction, particularly in tier one to tier, developed nations. We're not talking about massive new construction processes going on in places like China and India, but in developed countries, the movement of construction is going toward renovation and retrofit as opposed to construction. And in production, there has to be a way to really aggressively do energy and energy analysis and energy design around an existing condition. So one of the key ideas around BIM is how do you capture an existing condition, get it into a model, and save yourself time, energy, and cost by creating a transition of the workflow to manage it. One of the things we've been working on very hard in the building product line is the input of data from existing conditions, whether it's a standing building that's been out there for 50 years or a roadway or whatever, into the model-based environment. This is an example from a federal project that is doing a renovation retrofit of an MEP system. I can't really talk about the name of the federal project because it's confidential, but this is a real laser scan. It represents 26 million data points pulled into the Revit model. Creates a high fidelity starting point. It cut 50% of the time around a model-based process because they were able to input the existing condition through a laser scan into the Revit model. This is critically important for the building engineering segment of the building space, specifically MEP engineers, where much of the burden will fall on energy renovation and retrofit. Around sustainability measures. So really an important idea around the expansion of this. And, as I said, BIM is moving from, expanding workflow, but it's also expanding segments as well. I want to talk a little bit about the importance of the concepts of building information modeling to the contractor. The contractor is becoming the most vocal proponent and driver of building information modeling around the world, especially in this sophisticated construction segment. Because if you think about what's happened over the last couple of years, a lot of pressure has been put on the margin of the contractor. A lot of pressure because of the diminished pipelines and the the decreasing activity in new construction. So the contractor, they're fairly savvy, about their profitability, are looking to remediate the waste. They're looking to repatriate some of those dollars into their profits. So they're looking to move to reduce waste through decreasing inefficiencies and lack of productivity in the process. This is an example from the largest engineering company in Mexico called ICA. This is a revit structure model that was created with a lot of detail that was ultimately done for a bridge support footing. What happened was the engineering firm ICA passed this information to the contractor, who also was in a revit environment, and the contractor was able to query and analyze the model for, you know, to understand the structural integrity of what they were going to do around the rebar process. So a really important design to construction example where the contractor benefits by understanding the model better before it goes to physical construction. A really important workflow and change in the industry for the same player in the world. Now, as I said, BIM is not relegated to the building space. It has moved across segments in AEC. And I will be the first to admit, some of my team that's in this room were big advocates because they were hearing from my customers that civil engineers, the infrastructure professionals, they wanted some of that BIM. They wanted some of the value proposition of BIM. Why is it only focused on the building segment? There's similar problems. And a number of years ago, I said, well, you know, I don't know that concept or term will resonate with the infrastructure. Well, I'll tell you, standing here, I was definitely not right about that. Infrastructure professionals really understand the concept of BIM. The term resonates with them, and they are rallying around the idea. And I can tell you that from personal interaction with many of the most important infrastructure companies around the world. These guys really want to expand the use of technology and BIM tools across their workflow. Whether it's the plan, design, construction, or manage phase of a project. This is an example of a new idea that we're coming out with that you're going to hear a little bit more about later, called Project Galileo. It is an early mapping, a 3D conceptual mapping and planning tool that is going to allow for more early stage planning of a city or infrastructure environment. This conceptual design led to the creation of a renovation and retrofit process for roads and utilities in this environment. This is done by our customer in Nice, France, called AEC Informatique. More and more early stage conceptual planning is going to be done in BIM tools like Project Galileo and ultimately Map3D. We're seeing more and more of this, but early important area for BIM. Now BIM then moves from planning to detail to conceptual and detailed design, where more simulation and analysis can occur. Civil 3D is our core BIM product for detailed design and analysis. It includes leading simulation and analysis capabilities so that designers, engineers, and heavy construction companies can really experience their designs as deeply and as completely before they're real. This is an example of a rendered model coming out of Civil 3D that includes roadway, rail, bridge, utility systems done by Wigan Council, which is a UK government agency. This ultimately is rendered right out of the model that allows the engineers to really experience what would be the finished product after the modeling process, you know, before they actually go through construction. Okay, and then BIM is also expanding in the infrastructure space into other areas of infrastructure, not just around roads and highway and land development and transportation, but also water and wastewater. You can see here, this is a model that's used to simulate wastewater and storm systems to ensure adequate capacity, so you can see the water filling, and the analysis being done through Civil 3D, and it's very capable storm and sanitary analysis technology. So again, very important idea around water, wastewater management, and routing, and you can see some of the analysis tools we've built into the portfolio to accomplish that. Okay, so I wanted to, I talked about some, you know, through a little bit of the lens of the customer, some of these projects and workflows and segments that BIM's expanded in, and I think really compelling, the expansion of BIM. But I wanted to talk about it in a little more detail through the lens of our customers. And through the lens of some pretty important customers, pretty big, influential customers in the world, utilizing and executing on BIM. This is an image of what some of you saw in the gallery outside, which is Shanghai Tower. This is the new iconic kind of a very identifiable skyline structure that's going into Shanghai. The Pudong side, here, Shanghai Tower. We have a laser cut model out there. We have a bunch of BIM information out there. Please have a look at the exhibit on a break or whenever you can. The gallery has some really cool BIM-oriented exhibits around what's being done out in front of the Shanghai Tower. Shanghai Tower is going to be the fourth largest building in the world when it's complete in 2013. It's absolutely going to redefine the Shanghai skyline, as you can see here. I mean, this is a great idea. I mean, if any of you have been to Shanghai, this is the most recognizable building in Shanghai right now. And you can see how this skyline will change with the creation of this building. Total construction area, 576,000 square feet. I think this building is impressive both for its sustainable design goals and also for its innovation goals around design. And both are equally important. So if you think about what's going on in this building, the building facade is designed to reduce wind loads and to capture rainwater to drive some of the heating and cooling system. So again, design coupled with sustainability to create an independent structure that handles energy and resources better. It's double skin to create almost an insulation layer around the building. Wind turbines are producing electricity for the building in terms of power. A lot of things are being thought through by the Shanghai Tower Construction and Development Corporation to create a sustainable result. They're driving for a LEED Gold standard for this building, and ultimately a three-star sustainable certificate under the Chinese methodology and nomenclature. So really, very impressive building trying to go for sustainable authorization. This kind of project is simply not possible without a sophisticated technology. Simply not possible. Couldn't have built this building in this capacity without the tools of BIM, without the software that drives BIM. And knowing that, Shanghai Tower Construction and Development Corporation, the owner here, really drove BIM into the process. They mandated BIM from building design through construction, and they will also be driving the use of that information into the management process around the building. So once this is complete, the owner plans to drive the actual operation, maintenance management, facility management, etc., off of the BIM model. Very important idea for BIM as this information extends to the most expensive part of the building's life cycle, which is the operation phase. So I wanted to share that the products that were used on this were pretty expansive. Which is pretty typical now of moderately to high sophistication levels of projects, where a lot of our products are now being used in tandem to drive our results. So in this case, all the Revits were used, Navisworks are used, iNavisworks, Ecotech, 3DS Max Design, and of course AutoCAD are all used on this project in conjunction with one another to really drive the results. So a great example of a customer expanding their idea of BIM, expanding the portfolio that he used. Okay, so BIM, as I said, BIM resonates in the building space, but it also resonates very deeply with the infrastructure professionals around the world. This is an example of the Washington Department of Transportation project going on that exists in Seattle around the Seattle Waterfront Highway. There was a portion of the Seattle Waterfront Highway that was really, it was identified by the Washington DOT to be replaced with a subsurface bored tunnel underground. Now you can imagine, when you take a portion of Waterfront Highway and you decide to submerge it, the kinds of conflicts and issues that result, both from right-of-way passage to commuter traffic to transit systems, etc. Very complicated project. The tunnel is going to be 55 feet in diameter, which will make it the largest subsurface support tunnel in the world. It will house utilities, it will have passage areas for emergency evacuation, etc. So it's going to be a very large and encompassing tunnel. And the Washington DOT and the City of Seattle decided to really commit to BIM as the means and methods for driving this project. If you think about why they did it, a couple of reasons. First of all, they've got a very complicated, integrated design and construction process. They needed complex tools to do that. They needed comprehensive tools. They also had a very large emotionally connected constituency that needed to be communicated with through the project. Think about the Bay Bridge thing that we've talked about in the past. Think about a lot of these large infrastructure projects that require the city or the county or the state or the federal government to talk to its users in a way that explains the disruption they're going to go through. And they found that BIM as a visualization, as a communication tool, was extremely powerful. The Wash DOT built these models from the ground up for this structure. They are using it for simulation and for analysis. And what they found in this process was Washington DOT started to gain more and more confidence in the use of BIM, such that now they've committed to BIM technology, Autodesk BIM technologies, to drive a 6-mile patch of road width that's going on in Washington, a $4.5 billion project that will have the largest floating bridge in the world. So more complex, more fairly iconic infrastructure projects happening in the BIM portfolio because of success on projects. And in this case, the tools that were used to drive this project, Civil 3D, 3ds Max Design, and Mavis, all in conjunction together to drive the results. So, you know, another great project around BIM in the area of infrastructure. And then finally, the last customer is kind of breaking news today. I wanted to share with you guys some information about, and so we're particularly excited about partnering with the U.S. Air Force, and I'm announcing today that we're partnering with the U.S. Air Force on a $26 million contract over 5 years for our BIM, the scope of which is our entire BIM portfolio, the entire portfolio for Autodesk, where, that includes Map 3D and Civil 3D and the Revit products and Navisworks and Inventor and AutoCAD and LT, where the U.S. Air Force is committing to our BIM technologies to drive future construction, renovation, development around their Air Force bases around the world. Now, keep in mind, the U.S. Air Force has a tremendous amount of real estate, very expensive real estate that it has to manage, operate, and construct all over the world. 166 bases, 166 bases, 60,000 civil engineers in their network. The portfolio, the amount of work they do on this base population is $12 billion of work every year, and they're committing to a BIM workflow. One of the first projects is this one I'm showing here, the McGill Air Force Base in Florida, which is committed to a BIM workflow to drive its construction. It's planned to be the first lead building in the U.S. Air Force portfolio. So, really targeting sustainable requirements. It will be the flagship facility for the Department of Defense. And the BIM model is being used for a lot of different things on this project, from structural analysis to automated clash detection, okay, from resolving design conflicts all the way through to analyzing line of sight for antenna tower and Air Force communication structures. So lots and lots of things being driven from the BIM model on the Air Force base here in the Hill. And a great example of how the U.S. Air Force is really embracing the concept of BIM. Now, keep in mind that the U.S. Air Force construction managers have looked for efficient and productive ways to drive behavior in their bases for a long time. And I think some of these things happen as a result of each other. So if you think about in the U.S., the General Services Administration moving to a BIM, a mandatory BIM methodology through the process, the U.S. Army Corps doing the same, this is a logical consequence of some of those actions as well. We're really pleased to partner with U.S. Air Force, and they're integrating all of our BIM tools into their workflow. So excited about this, excited to announce this today. So, I've opened here with a fairly expansive perspective on the concept of BIM, both from a workflow standpoint and from a discipline standpoint. BIM is expanding. BIM is moving faster than I've seen things move in the global AEC industry throughout my career, because the industry's changing today. And the industry's transforming today. From a workflow standpoint, from a work process standpoint, and it's really rallying around more efficient, more productive construction. Autodesk's BIM serves multiple segments, so all the building segments, all the infrastructure segments, etc. It solves workflows from concept design through construction all the way into operations. We'll hear much more detail about all of these workflows and segments over the next few days. I wanted to talk very quickly about something, preview something that my colleague Rick Rendell will be talking about in a couple of, right after the next session around data management, because as BIM proliferates, as information starts to become more and more readily available to practitioners and contractors around the world, there's a real big need to manage that information. And so Autodesk has been really pleased to announce this at this event that we're coming to market with a AEC version of Vault with Buzzsaw entitlements and integrated Mavis workflow to create a data management solution. You will hear more detail about, so stay tuned. It's really very powerful in the market, and our customers are really excited about. So we believe it's incumbent upon us to be in the data management space to manage much of this information, and we will with a set of tools. So, to summarize, I'm really excited about the release. I'm really excited about some of the productivity and accuracy and efficiency that that release represents, that this set of products represents. Really excited about the expansion of BIM and how Autodesk has invested through the recession and through some of the tougher time to make sure our portfolio meets the needs of the professional. And I hope you'll hear that over the next couple of days. And I want to hand it over, this is my last slide, I want to hand it over to my colleague and friend here, Richard Harpum, who's going to talk to you about a different methodology around go-to-market, which is around suites. Some of you heard on the meeting call a couple weeks ago and know a little bit about our approach to the go-to-market around suites. In my industry, in the AEC industry here, the flagship suites that we'll be coming to market with are around building design and infrastructure design suite, and we think that this will be a much simplified methodology for customers to absorb our technologies. This is a portfolio of products that really resonates with our customers, and you're going to hear from Richard a little bit about the thinking around suites, how we're putting these products together, and how we're going to market them. So with that said, let me thank you all for attending again. Let me thank you for your attention in this opening session, and let me pass it on to Richard Harper, who's going to talk about suites. Thank you very much.